the most rewarding thing for me, which probably I didn't express so thoroughly in my talk, is just the pleasure of collaborating with the USA and Japan on this over the years, and the success of that collaboration. I think it's been it's probably unique in science in some ways. As soon as the two projects were launched in Europe and the USA about the same time, and immediately the participants were of the kind of character that said the best way to work on this is to share our ideas, and I mean sharing data was important, but it was also a sharing of ideas, and that made that was beneficial intellectually, and also I think it's been crucial in maintaining the right of access to this data, because basically that it's like three continents have agreed that this is a shared resource for the public good, and so that makes it very difficult for anyone to take any kind of protectionist view of the information. Of course, I'm proud of the fact as well that in Europe that has built into something which has been which has become a very significant resource in the provision of biomolecular data, that is the EBI, and you know, NCBI is in some ways similar and in some ways different in the USA, but I think that it's we're dealing in a kind of science whose ultimate record is electronic, of necessity because of its sheer volume, and I think that we're custodians of that scientific record, and that's a crucial job. And in fact, as Rich Roberts pointed out today, of course, we're getting to the stage where the primary literature can be shared in the same way. And I think that what we're really this is really central to the advance of science, that there is this shared record which is electronic. And I think that Genbank and this collaboration have seeded that mood in the life sciences, and I think the life sciences are very advanced in their thinking in that direction, perhaps by comparison with some of the other sciences. Everyone understood that the rate of determination of DNA sequences would accelerate, and that there would be a huge volume of data. The scale of that data explosion was estimated. Estimates differed by three orders of magnitude. So to say that anyone got it right, or to say that we collectively got it right, would be a bit of a bold statement. In terms of I think that what was more interesting from my perspective in looking at it in Europe was the scale of the general information about biomolecular systems in general. So not just GenBank, but as Jim Estelle pointed out today in his talk, the connections between different kinds of information. And I think we sort of foresaw that, but I think we didn't quite understand how important that was going to be. I think we're always slightly arrogant about what we're going to achieve. I mean, and I think there's certainly a way of looking, for example, at the Human Genome Project and saying it actually told us less than we expected it to, in the sense that there is a way of looking at it that says the human genome is actually a lot simpler than we expected. Now, actually, that may be slightly naive, but if you stick with that for a little while and say, okay, the human genome is not as complicated as it might have been, then all of the you still have to explain all of the complexity of living systems, and the fact, we still know that there are millions of molecules active in cells, and we don't quite know how they interact with each other. So we're a long way from understanding how even one cell works, despite the fact that we have all that information. If you'd said to me at the beginning of this project that we would be sequencing DNA from buckets of seawater without knowing what organisms we're getting, I would have been surprised, but actually, that's revealed to us that not just the complexity of the genome, but the complexity of the biosphere constantly surprises us. So there is an enormous complexity out there to be understood, and it's exciting, but at the same time daunting to think of that complexity.